knows a lot about the science stuff. Professor Dave explains.
In the previous tutorial, we learned about what platelets are and how they are activated, and we also introduced the concept of antiplatelet drugs. So now it's time to understand precisely how these drugs work mechanistically to reduce blood clotting. First, let's recall that platelet activation easily snowballs in a positive feedback loop to establish further rapid activation that involves multiple interconnected receptor systems, leading to the stabilization of a thrombotic plug. It's important to note that although platelet aggregation is a process that underlies pathology, such as myocardial infarctions and strokes, it is also an essential physiological process that prevents excessive bleeding from some internal injuries and superficial wounds by forming an insoluble aggregate, sometimes known as a scab. So any manipulation of this system must be done carefully. With that understood, let's take a look at how antiplatelet agents mediate their inhibitory effects. The modern gold standard of pharmacological practice to reduce thrombus formation in cases of arterial coronary syndromes is through the implementation of two drugs given concurrently in a strategy known as dual antiplatelet therapy. This revolves around the use of aspirin and a P2Y12 receptor antagonist. P2Y12 receptor antagonists block the function of ADP at this receptor, which, as we discussed, are prothrombotic through its reduction of intracellular C-AMP concentrations. P2Y12 antagonists such as clopidogrel and prasugrel are prodrugs requiring hepatic metabolism to form an active metabolite that are irreversible antagonists. This means that they covalently bind to the binding site that ADP usually occupies, thereby blocking its function. Another newer, structurally distinct drug, known as ticagrelor, doesn't require hepatic activation and doesn't covalently bind to the P2Y12 receptor, but does act as an inverse agonist, which reduces the spontaneous activation of the P2Y12 receptor. This inverse agonism confers a greater platelet inhibitory effect than prasugrel and clopidogrel, due not only to blocking endogenous ADP binding and subsequent receptor activation, but also reducing the spontaneous agonist-independent activity of the receptor. Aspirin, which we have discussed extensively in a previous tutorial, is an NSAID, or non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug, that irreversibly antagonizes cyclooxygenase enzymes and inhibits the synthesis of thromboxane A2 from arachidonic acid precursor. Check the tutorial on aspirin for more information on this mechanism. When less thromboxane A2 is produced through COX inhibition, this reduces activation of the thromboxane receptor due to less agonist being present, hence the term antithrombotic. It can be appreciated that a dual antiplatelet therapy approach targets distinct platelet activation pathways, and as a result, these therapies are synergistic in reducing adverse thrombotic events. It's important to be aware that bleeding risk and thrombotic risk are a critical seesaw-like balance that must be managed carefully, as we mentioned at the beginning of this tutorial. On either extreme lies a particular danger. Extensive bleeding can arise from platelet inhibition because the ability of the body to generate blood clots is reduced. But on the other hand, insufficient platelet inhibition can lead to thrombosis and subsequent heart disease and stroke for those who are at risk for these events. Therefore, it is very important to strike a balance between two extremes, and pushing too far in one direction can indeed be fatal by virtue of either hemorrhage or cardiovascular disease. With platelet physiology and the mechanism of antiplatelet drugs now understood, let's move on and check out other types of anticoagulants next.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.